Hello friends, today I will give a short presentation on algorithms with HTML5 Canvas. The purpose of this presentation is to provide you with a basic understanding of HTML5 Canvas for applications that you may find useful for algorithms in the future. I will explain and demonstrate how HTML5 Canvas allows for HTML code and script to dynamically generate graphics. These graphics include graphs, animations, games, as well as image compositions. Here is a brief history of HTML5 Canvas. HTML5 Canvas was first introduced in 2004 by Apple to render their dashboard widgets, applications, and elements for the Safari browser. The world clock widget for the dashboard is a good example. It was based on Quartz 2D for drawing in two-dimensional space. In 2005, it was adopted by Gecko and Opera browsers, and by 2006, was then standardized by the Web Hypertext Application Technology Working Group and became fully accepted by the W3C. What are the applications for HTML5 Canvas? While most developers in the past relied on a limited system to deliver web-based graphics, PNG, JPEG, and bitmap formats were used to present graphic elements on websites. All of these graphic elements were static, meaning that they were produced outside of the website's HTML code and are unresponsive to events happening within the websites. HTML5 Canvas produces a region on the web page that allows you to set the height and width attributes. Using JavaScript and HTML codes, you can send drawing functions to dynamically generate graphics. This type of rendering maximizes the performance of your website by bypassing the need to load images. With Canvas, we can draw shapes and lines, arcs and text, gradients and patterns. In addition, Canvas gives us the power to manipulate pixels to animate images and even video. There are the differences between Flash versus HTML5. Everyone is familiar with Adobe Flash Player and for many years have been the provider of most online animation and video content. Your web browser cannot play the content on its own. A Flash player is needed to render media. Comparatively, HTML5 contents are rendered with the CPU and your computer's dedicated hardware, thus improving performance. The majority of today's web browsers support HTML5. YouTube, the largest repository of video content, has dropped Flash and has made HTML5 the default player. The biggest factor that is driving the demand towards HTML5 is the increased use of mobile devices. Unlike Flash, HTML5 content functions without the need of any plugins for your browser, and one code is all that is needed for devices. This allows the developer to create code that will work for mobile devices as well as PCs. The Game Development Society is one movement that is expanding the use of HTML5 by producing HTML5-driven games that does not need to be installed in a device. This is because the games run on HTML5 and script code that functions within a real-time execution. Since the games can run on real-time execution, it can take advantage of input from client-server communications that allow multiplayer games. Let us take a look at the HTML5 Canvas code. HTML5 is the latest iteration of the HTML language and includes the elements from both the past versions of HTML4 and XHTML 1.0. Basically, the code mostly resembles the HTML code that you are used to. The main difference is, HTML5 features new elements. Some of these include drawing with the canvas element, online storage, the new video and audio elements, drag and drop functionality, microdata, and embedded fonts. Let us now implement the canvas element. You can do this by simply declaring the canvas tag within the body of your page. Inside the canvas tag, you can assign the tag with an ID to name the specific area you will draw in and include the dimensions of width and height. This will be the area that any drawing and animation will be rendered. Next, in our head tag, we will attach an onload function that will auto-load our canvas area when our web page is opened. This code needs to appear within the script tags, as the code is JavaScript. We now instantiate our canvas tag by attaching our designated area that we declared in the body tag. Now we assign the canvas to a variable that we can use repeatedly within a two-dimensional value. Next step is to assign the background color to our canvas area, and then we fill the area according to the X parameter, Y parameter, and width and height. Next up, we will draw a line and first need to assign a stroke style color for our line. Also, the line width that is measured in pixels. To draw a line, JavaScript has to make an initial path in our canvas. We assign the path origin to an X and Y coordinate, and then an endpoint to where the line ends and then fill it with a stroke. You can double the path, continue drawing to a new endpoint, and then close the path to connect to the origin point. Similarly, placing text on your canvas is just as simple. First, you need to designate a fill style, and then the pixel size and font. Second, you will need to display the text by writing in the string, the X coordinate and the Y coordinate. Drawing a circle is a little bit more tricky. The tricky part is that we need to use a little bit of math. Like the path samples, we designate a fill style and open a path, but drawing circles need a more elaborate syntax. Here, we create an arc syntax that features the X coordinate, Y coordinate, the radius in pixels, the origin point, math pi angle, and whether or not it is clockwise or counterclockwise. Now, we have come to the segment that truly defines the capacity of HTML5 Canvas, algorithms for HTML5 Canvas animation. Every object drawn on canvas can be animated. This allows for all levels of animation to be created, from simple movements to complex kinetic variations. We will start with the setInterval function that is commonly used to animate objects on HTML5 Canvas. The setInterval function, in a sense, draws the canvas over and over at a set time interval. We will take an object we have already created, like this text object, and add animation to it. First, we use the setInterval function syntax that designates the frame per second. In this case, it is 30 frames per second. Within the setInterval function braces, we can copy and paste the canvas elements along with the text element. You can say that whatever exists inside this setInterval code will be redrawn at every frame. Next, we create a variable for position x that will place the item on x-coordinate plane. We do the same for the position y. Within our setInterval function, we set the position x and position y. Now, we can set the position x to increment the set value per frame load, in this case, 2 pixels. As you can see when we load it, our object moves across the x position. We now write in an if conditional that when x reaches a certain value, the y plane activates. For a more elaborate animation, we can set new trajectories for our motion by designating boundaries. To do this, we introduce 2 new variables in our algorithm, direction x and direction y. With these new variables, we can control the direction of our object. We set our boundaries with 2 if statements, one for the x plane and the other for the y plane. We then set the incrementers for the directional headings of x and y. The result, as you can see, is that object now moves within the boundaries of the canvas. To add a cool effect, we can play with the gamma values of the canvas to add some trippy trails. As I mentioned earlier, anything that can be drawn on canvas can be animated. We can now take this code and apply it to the other objects that we have created. Let us now incorporate some algorithmic terms that we are familiar with. In this example, we will implement the math.random function to create a cool animation on our text object. Our goal here is to make a particle type animation where our text will be generated in different positions. Math.random, as you know, can generate numbers arbitrarily. Using a for loop, we will generate 10 new text objects that we can incorporate our math.random functions with. In this createParticle function, we will attach the math.random syntax to our x and y coordinates, also to the velocity on the x-plane and the y-plane. The results, as you can see, have generated several text objects at random positions with random velocity and directions. HTML5 Canvas is useful for simulating motion of natural objects. In this example, we will incorporate into our object simulated gravity. The code for simulated gravity affects the acceleration of an object that in turn affects the velocity. When working with gravity, we manipulate the object in the y-axis. As the ball drops, the velocity increases and the reciprocal force to emulate a falling object. Using variables for weight and velocity, we can change how the simulated gravity can interact with a heavy object or a light object. In this example, provided to us by our very own illustrious coder, Jean-Boris Conan, HTML5 Canvas is shown to simulate Newton's second law of motion. Here, Jean's code takes into consideration how mass affects the acceleration of an object. The greater the mass, the greater the amount of force is needed to move the object. Let us now explore our favorite type of algorithm, recursives. Recursives are functions that execute by referencing itself. This is a recursive program that I created called the Murphy's Cross. The Murphy's Cross recursive algorithm divides our canvas into four quadrants. Each of our endpoints either represent the edges or the midpoints of our canvas. We then create a variable for the count to set how many recursions will be performed. Next, we create a variable for the dividing value, which will be applied to our quadrants. In this case, 2, meaning our quadrants will be divided in half. Now, we create the recursive method of our program, to which we will send our count, endpoints, and the dividing value. Within our recursive function, we will implement a set interval function to animate our recursion. Next, we create the exit case by implementing an if conditional. This portion will print our cross and then decrement the count by one value. Our endpoints will now be divided by our set value. And then lastly, we call our function again. As you can see, the cross is being recursed into the first quadrant and is being reduced to half of its size. Let us decrease our dividing factor to create different patterns. Reverting back to the initial dividing value of 2, we now iterate on the second quadrant. Now, we iterate the third quadrant, and then the last. Here is another recursive pattern called the Sierpinski's triangle. The mechanics of this recursive algorithm is similar to our Murphy's Cross, in which each object is being divided in half. The difference in this case is that the algorithm is applied to triangles instead of rectangles. This next segment is the kaleidoscope recursion. The mechanics of this recursion implements the math.py and math.sin functions. It creates intricate patterns with lines arranged in a circle. In conclusion, HTML5 Canvas is a powerful tool for generating graphics. The type of controls offered through HTML5 Canvas makes it ideal for algorithmic applications. Canvas has many useful features. It is interactive and can respond to a user's action and events. Every object that is drawn in Canvas can be animated, which makes it suitable for displaying algorithmic concepts. The flexibility of Canvas can create just about anything needed for any web application. It is steadily becoming a web standard and is implemented by most browsers. The Canvas application can run anywhere, and it's free. I hope you have learned some things about HTML5 Canvas that you may find useful in your profession as a technical programmer. Thank you for giving this a view.